Yes. 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 Thank you. Thank you, one and all. My goodness. Thank you to all, 3,000 of you currently in this chat. My goodness. I don't even know what's going on. This is ridiculous. This is insane. This is insane. Adam, you can stop clapping. It's all good. I'm excited. A few days ago, we came up with this crazy idea to build a talk show set in the basement of my Animal Crossing house. Just a few days later, we have built something beyond anything I could ever have imagined. It's ridiculous. We'll get into that in a moment. It's I don't even know where to start with what's going on right now. Adam, I'm actually quite nervous. How about you?
I totally haven't been feeling it all day and being incredibly uncomfortable, incredibly anxious and freaking out. And
yeah, I think as we get into the groove, we're gonna find our way here. So, you know, we've been averaging a couple of hundred viewers, maybe, you know, on a good night. We've done a few of these shows, but tonight, Adam, tonight, something very special is happening. We're on the Twitch front page tonight. Can you believe that?
Boy.
We are on the Twitch front page. And you know what? I'm going to prove it to you. There it is. There it is. We are on the Twitch front page.
Oh my goodness.
It's I don't even know what to say to you right now. This is crazy. We did this because we were kind of bored, you know, everyone's locked indoors, you know, the lockdown, the coronavirus, all that stuff's happening. And I did this just as an escape, as a fun thing. And I guess it's turned into like, you know, right now everyone's just looking for like a way to kind of put a smile on their face. And if this is putting a smile on anyone's face, then I couldn't be happier about it. The way that this show has blown up in just the last few, this is only our fourth show. Can you believe? We feel like been doing this for years. This is our fourth show. Can you believe that,
yeah,
Adam?
It does feel like we've been doing it a long time. We worked so long and hard for this Twitch front page.
Oh my God! Like out. I mean, like four days. I mean, that's crazy. That's a long time in a Twitch career. This is not as big a deal, but I also got I had no idea, but like my poor little YouTube channel, which used to just host my sad PUBG clips that nobody ever watched. We just passed 2,000 subs and I'm getting congratulatory emails from YouTube. I don't even know what's going on with that. That's nutty. And Adam, you've got
quite impressive.
I don't even know what to say. Look at this. Just look at this. We're in Entertainment Weekly. We are in Entertainment Weekly. 6 million.
Man.
I mean, Polygon, Game Informer, GameSpot, they've all covered this. And that's great. You know, we're gamers. This is started as a game channel. That's our background. But we're on another level.
Did it say Adam Nickerson in that article?
Let's take a look here. Let's see what it says. Adam Nickerson, video editor and game developer.
Oh,
look at
boy.
You. Look at you.
That's me. I'm at Entertainment Weekly.
Look at me, Ma. You've hit the big time, Adam. You've hit the big time. Congratulations. Oh, yeah, so you have a new keyboard. Let's check it out. So we've been building this little band area over here. Let's go check out the band area. So we started with this with an electric guitar. We added a drum kit, a saxophone, and now this wonderful keyboard. Give us a few bars on that synthesizer.
This is a little ditty I've been working on.
Okay. I'm digging it. I'm digging it. I'm loving it. I'm loving it right now. And I should also point out, like, you know, the fact that we're able to build this talk show set, and I'm a big fan of these late night talk shows. To me, it's a part of a classic kind of part of American culture. And the set that we've built here is really kind of a tribute and an homage to so many of my favorite talk shows. An astute observer will notice that we are between two ferns.
Ooh.
We're between two ferns. We've got the golf clubs over here are kind of, again, this is a bit of a deep cut, but the golf clubs are kind of a Johnny Carson call out. Johnny Carson, during his monologues, would always kind of love to play golf and would fake a little golf swing when he hit a joke out of the park during his monologue. And the green, obviously the cityscape back there is, you know, every talk show you've ever seen. And the abundance of greenery back there is a reference to my personal favorite talk show of all time. And it's not even a real one, the Larry Sanders Show. If you know that, if you watch the Larry Sanders Show, you'll know that Artie, the producer, he loved his greenery. And if anyone even touched one leaf, he would know. And so the plants back there are a tribute to Artie and the late, great Rip Torn, who played him on the show. And then, I mean, so many other things. You know, it's funny. I went last night, just for fun, I went back and watched the classic Seinfeld episode where Kramer finds the set for the old Merv Griffin show in a dumpster, and he rebuilds the Merv Griffin show in his apartment. Incredible, incredible episode. And I guess that's kind of what we're doing here. It's true. I'm nervous because, you know, this thing has blown up in a way that this was just like I just did this on a lark. It was just a silly thing. And look at us now. It's nutty. Like, I don't know what's going to happen next. I've got real agents calling me trying to get celebrity guests on this show. It's ridiculous. I don't even know where to start. And I tell you, let me tell you something. This is how you know you've really arrived. I didn't tell you this yet, Adam. I'm telling you now for the first time live on the show. You know you really hit the big time when you start getting rejected by major celebrities. So now I want to be very clear here. I did not solicit. A lot of people got very excited. They've been reaching out. They've been tweeting at Brie Larson and Chrissy Teigen and Elijah Wood and these, you know, celebrities that are known to play Animal Crossing because they would love to come on the show. And of course, I would too. Any of them, of course, would be very welcome at any time. But I had a friend call me up. He said, "You know what? I know some sports agents. I think I can get Steph Curry on the show." And I didn't say like, "Get out of here! You're full of crap" or whatever. I just kind of said, "Okay, go for it. Let's see if you can deliver." And within an hour, he texted me back, said, "Oh yeah, Steph Curry passed." I mean, is anyone surprised? Someone tweeted at William Gibson, the legendary novelist and author, futurist. This is kind of the future that you predicted. You should come on the show. Again, I'm not doing this. I'm just getting tagged in these tweets. Other people are kind of running off on their own volition and doing this stuff.
Yeah.
And William very kindly tweeted back, "I worry that if I do that, it'll cause some kind of singularity." And that was his very nice, clever way of passing. So I thought that was sweet. But you know what? Who needs these big-time celebrities? Let me tell you something. There's going to be two kinds of guests on this show. There's going to be either someone who is so famous I can't say no to them. Like, you've got to get them on the show because it's going to help the show grow. That may happen in the near future. But it's also going to be, like, I've already got guests booked up for like a couple of weeks ahead of time. Like my friend Kate, who was on the show a couple of nights ago.
Kate was incredible.
She was a great guest. She kind of helped us work the bugs out of the system. And she falls into that category of like, she's not like a super duper famous celebrity, but she's a friend and she's a cool person. You know, if you're one of my friends and I think you're cool and interesting and I want to talk to you, you're getting on the show. And I'll pass over big time celebs to get my friends on the show, because that's what this is all about. We created this as a way just to kind of have fun with our friends. And that's what we're going to do. I don't care if I never make a nickel off of this show. That's not what we're doing this for. I make plenty of money in my day job. But you know what? I'm already kind of thinking about quitting my day job, Adam. I'm thinking, I've had more fun doing this in the last week than in the last year doing my regular job.
You can do this for 50 years.
I mean, you know, how long was Johnny Carson host of The Tonight Show?
187.
Yeah, I mean, I think we can beat that. Having said that, when I said like it's either going to be famous people or people who are good friends of mine on Friday's show, because we have another show coming up on Friday.
How do I do a gasp? Is there a gasp?
Oh, yeah, that's good enough. That's a good one. I'm going to do that too. I like that one. What's that one called? It's called Encouragement, isn't it? Encouragement? Yeah, there we go. Wait until you see the guests. Wait until you see the guests we have lined up for you on Friday. Because we're actually going to work in a regular schedule here. Stream, like professional streamers will tell you, got to have a schedule, got to stream on a schedule. So here's how it's going to work from now on. My previous Animal Crossing show, Animal Crossing Mornings, that's going to continue. Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursday mornings at 9 a.m. on this very channel, we're gonna continue with Animal Crossing Mornings. But on Wednesday night, we're going to have a show, just like we're having right now. And on Monday mornings and Friday mornings at 9 a.m., we're going to be right back here with Animal Talking. And our first Friday show is going to be coming up on this very Friday. Someone in chat just pointed out your pants are fantastic. I noticed that you changed the color of your pants from the run through earlier today. You had green ones earlier. Now they're kind of this silver sequin number. What is that all about?
Can you see what's on my back?
Let me see if I can angle the camera in here for a better look.
Here, let me go closer.
Yeah.
There you go.
Oh, it's kind of a cool bulldog. Is that a custom design or is that something that was in the Able Sisters store?
Just a little thing I snagged over at Able Sisters on sale.
I'm loving it.
Big deal.
I'm loving it. Friday, and I love it when you do that. It makes my unfunny jokes funny. on Friday, we're going to have two people who are both very good friends of mine and actually legitimately famous. I know, right? On Friday, 9 a.m. Pacific time, we're going to be joined by writer-director Duncan Jones, the director of Moon, Source Code, the Warcraft movie, and also my good friend Felicia Day, creator of The Guild, star of Buffy the Vampire Slayer, Supernatural. They're both going to be on the couch here, 9 a.m. Pacific, this very Friday. That's less than 24 hours away. So if you haven't already followed this channel, now's the time to get in on that action.
Oh, boy.
Oh, my God. Now, we have a pact. Not only is this the biggest show we've done in terms of our audience, because, again, we're on that sweet, sweet, sweet Twitch front page, but also it's the biggest show in terms of guests, in terms of each show. You know, we've gotten a little bit better at adding more bells and whistles, more transitions. I've been learning a lot about how to operate Streamlabs. Adam, you've been super, super helpful with some of the technical behind-the-scenes stuff. A man of many talents, both technical and artistic. By the way, Adam,
I'll tell you what I used to do.
Yeah. You kind of insulted me the other day when you were helping out with tech support, and you said, you know, this is nothing new to me because I used to run a tech support company that specialized in helping seniors. And I wasn't quite sure how to comprehend that. I understand what you were saying, but I was nevertheless offended. We got a packed show tonight. We've got three guests on the show. Comedian Mike Drucker is going to be here in just a moment. He's on deck right now, waiting upstairs, waiting to come down the stairs, waiting for me to introduce him. Mary Kish from Twitch. Not only do we have comedy royalty on the show, we have Twitch royalty, like a proper person who works at Twitch. So that's amazing. And we have an amazing, amazing musical guest, Raquel Lily, who is one of the most talented musical talents on Twitch, is going to be joining us. And she's going to be singing and performing live. This is not going to be a recording or anything. She's going to perform live. And in fact, you can go to her Twitch channel, Eric, Adam, if you want to drop the link in the chat, twitch.tv/Raquel. You'll actually be, you can watch the stream of her avatar performing live on the show while she actually performs the song live on her own channel as well. So that's sick. That's amazing. We're pushing the boundaries here. We're pushing the frontiers of what is thought possible on Twitch.
I forgot.
Wouldn't you agree, Adam?
Yes, I would agree. I was panicking because I forgot to drop the link.
Okay. No, we got it. We got mods on the case as well. Don't worry about it. It's time to bring on our first guest. We promised comedy. We promised comedians, and we actually have here on the show tonight a real life comedian. He's a stand-up comic. He's a comedy writer. He's actually written for The Real Tonight Show. The guy who's about to come down the stairs has written for The Tonight Show with Jimmy Fallon. He's written for Saturday Night Live. He's written for Bill Nye Saves the World. He's written for Nintendo Treehouse. And he's currently the co-head writer of Full Frontal with Samantha Bee. And he recently won a Writers Guild Award for being the best goddamn comedy writer out there. Please welcome to the show. Please welcome my friend and yours, Mike Drucker. Here he is, everybody. My goodness, what an outfit. What an outfit. I've never seen anything quite like it.
Thank you. Thank you very much for having me.
Mike, thank you so much for joining us. You have blessed us with comedy royalty here tonight.
Thank you. I liked hearing the list of people who said no before I said yes.
No, but seriously, I mean, like, you're the real deal. I mean, you've written for Saturday Night Live, you've written for Jimmy Fallon, you've done all kinds of comedy. You're a terrific stand-up comedian in your own right, and you're the head writer for Samantha Bee. That's nutty. What I mean, do you feel like you're slumming it here a little bit?
No, I'm actually, like, way more nervous about this than, like, we have an episode that's airing tonight for Samantha Bee.
Okay.
I'm far more nervous about being here than I am about that episode airing.
But why?
Because, you know, you're a friend of mine, and this is my first virtual talk show I've done, so, you know, it's a little nerve-wracking. I'm actually, like, a little nervous. I'm not doing a bit. I'm kind of nervous.
I mean, I have been walking around in a daze all day worried about this show because I knew we were going to be on the front page, and it's a big deal. This is like a make or break moment for us. And let me tell, not to put those other shows down, because, you know, we're standing on the shoulder of those legendary shows that came before us. And I just want to make it perfectly clear. This is a real talk show. If that's not already clear to you, like, this is not a joke. I mean, there's going to be jokes, but, like, I'm sitting here with my note cards. You know, the guests come over, they do a pre-interview, they do sound checks. Like, this is a legitimate... The only difference is, you know, none of us have to leave the house, which, of course, for the coronavirus era, is perfect. And, Mike, yeah, all the shows you've worked on are great, but, like, they're not reinventing the goddamn zeitgeist like this one.
Yeah, you're reinventing the wheel with this. I'm so excited. When you did... When I came on, like, 6 hours earlier to go through the run-through, I was so jealous of everything about this set.
I gotta say, I think the credit goes to Nintendo. The fact that we were able to, you know, from, and again, I also want to take the time to thank my wife, Leah, who's an executive producer on the show, and to Adam, and to everyone who helped out by donating the items that we needed. And it really was a great kind of crowdsourced collaborative effort. But it's also a testament to Nintendo. They made so many amazing items in this game that we were actually able to recreate a late night talk show set. And it looks like the real deal. I mean, look at this thing. It's the real deal. It's absolutely insane. Mike, let's talk about you. That's why you're here. Let's talk about comedy.
Favorite topic.
First of all, you know, I introduced you as a, you know, you have been promoted all day as a comedian. It literally says on the bill, comedian Mike Drucker.
Yeah.
And this is, you know, there's a comedy element to this show. When you come on the show in that context, does that mean, do you feel the pressure to be funny? And by the way, you do have to be funny.
I definitely feel a little pressure to be funny, especially now. Yeah, I guess there's some pressure to be funny, but at the same time, without an audience, whether I'm funny or not, I get the same response. So, you know, I'm just going to do my best.
Well, I've seen your comedy. I know your writing. I have no doubt that your best is going to be more than good enough. You know, from following you on Twitter, because you do a lot of comedy on Twitter, and seeing some of your stand up, I don't know how much of it is real or how much of it is kind of played up for comedy, but I get the sense that you had this miserable childhood. And I wonder is it generally true that, like, kind of comedy is born out of pain, and a lot, you know, deep down underneath comedy, the funniest guys are actually the most miserable underneath, and the funniest guys and women. And that's where the comedy comes from.
You know, I get that question a lot. And I think, I don't know if comedians and, like, musicians and artists are sadder than most people. I just think that we're allowed to talk about sadder than other jobs. Like, if you had a dentist who was like, man, I want to kill myself, you wouldn't go to that dentist. But when there's a, like, if you have a mute, like a rock star who's like, I want to kill myself, you're like, yeah, man, I know how you feel. So we have a little more freedom as creative people to say we hate ourselves without someone slowly backing out of the door.
Because, like, I said to you, send me a clip that we can play on the show, and you sent me, like, a specific thing. And we're going to play it in a little bit. And I'm thinking, holy shit, like, Mike's comedy is dark. Like, it goes to some dark places. I mean, do you feel like that's your brand, that you're not afraid to kind of go to dark places with your comedy?
I think I like going to dark places. It's also sort of what I find funny. Like, I find it's almost a silly darkness. So it's not like murder's funny. It's more like my comedy's almost like a robot that almost falls in love but can't feel emotions. Does that make sense?
Falcon Boom in the chat just posted, I'm a dentist and I hate myself. So there you go.
There we go.
There you go.
I'd go to you as my dentist because you wouldn't yell at me about flossing. Like, I would be so on board with that.
Mike, I want to go ahead and show the first clip that you brought. Now, you are the head writer, the co-head writer. Who's your other head? Who's the other head writer? Who do you share that with?
She's a writer named Kristen Bartlett, and she is amazing. She's so funny.
Now, this is a clip from before you were head writer. This is when you were just regular old writer. But you said, like, why, let me ask, before we play it, explain to me, why this clip? Why did you choose to bring this clip to the show?
So one of the things that me and Kristen are known for on the show is pitching the dumbest possible ideas.
Right.
And so there used to be, obviously we have a political talk show. If you like it or not, I don't want to know. And there was obviously that woman, Sarah Huckabee Sanders, which was the press secretary for the president of the United States. For some reason, I came up with a pitch called Sarah Huckabot Sanders, and I pitched it sort of half as a joke, thinking it would never be made. And people were like, yeah, sure, let's build a robot. So our props department built a robot basically out of garbage. And we had it on the show twice, but then she immediately retired. And when she retired, I asked us to give her a farewell, and we needed like a minute and a half in the show. So they were like, great. And this is what came out.
All right. So we're going to roll this clip. This is a sketch that Mike Drucker wrote from Full Frontal with Samantha Bee.
Sadly, this is Sarah Huckabee Sanders' last week in the White House. We truly wish her the best in her next endeavor, trying to kill Harry Potter. Unfortunately, that also means we'll be saying goodbye to our Android correspondent, Sarah Huckabot Sanders. Fare thee well, you magnificent killjoy.
Daisy, Daisy, give me your answer, dear. I'm half crazy, all for the love of you. It won't be a stylish marriage. I can't afford a carriage, but you'll look sweet up on the ship of a bicycle built for two.
So, I mean, there is something deeply disturbing about that.
It's the least amount of writing I've ever done for the show, and maybe my favorite thing I've ever done for the show.
It's your favorite. It's the favorite bit that you've done.
It's my favorite bit. I had to explain to people, like one or two people got the 2001 reference, and I had to explain to the rest of them that song. And Kristen, who's the new co-head writer with me, she's the voice of Huckabot. And we were in a sound booth for maybe half an hour. I was like, no, do it this way. No, do it this way. Beating her up to get it the way I wanted a robot to sing its goodbye song.
I don't know if it's the voice. Maybe I think the voice is a big part of this. Something, just something really unsettling about it. And I guess that was the point, right?
Yeah. It was, well, because I don't know. It's this thing writing on that show. It's dealing with sad stuff every day. And the thing that Kristen and I like doing that is hard to do is we try to make it lighter. Like, you know, obviously these are super sad topics, so we try to find the goofiest way to address the darkness, and Huckabot was one of those ways.
How's it been running the show under the quarantine? Because I know a lot of the talk show hosts, they've gone lo-fi, they're doing it from their houses. What's been the Sam B approach to that?
The Sam B approach has been, we're all working remotely. Sam's husband, Jason Jones, was another person who was on The Daily Show the same time she was. And so he knows his way around a camera. So they're actually shooting with an iPhone 11 with one of those little attachments that like film students use to make it look more professional.
Right.
So they're literally filming the show on an iPhone 11 with a sound pack that they were mailed. And all of the footage is sent to the editors and they edit it. So everything's done remotely. The nice thing that the show is doing is that they're paying all of the crew still. So all of the crew is getting paid 8-hour days. The cameramen, the lighting people, the sound people, they're all still getting paid even though they're currently not working.
Yeah, it's amazing. I'm still just so amazed that you're here, Mike. And Adam, I don't want to freak you out, but I just checked and we're currently going out to more than 6,000 people on Twitch.
Yeah, yeah.
That's, why are you looking sad? You should be happy.
I just have sigh because there's no anxiety button.
Yeah, the game needs more neuroses emotes. Yeah. Mike, I want to talk to you about video games since you're here, because I think that's how we first came to know each other. We're doing this talk show inside the world of a video game right now.
Yeah.
And we both love video games. Tell me about your video game life. Were video games something that helped you get through that childhood we were talking about?
They definitely helped me get through the childhood. They were almost, I think people think of, whenever people say video games were my refuge from real life, it was, to me, it wasn't even like that. It was almost like video games were my real life, and then I would have to come out of that sometimes for everything else.
I hear that.
I was so into video games. I was so into JRPGs. I was so into games like Civilization and the SimCity and The Sims, where you could just build a life and go away. Basically, I used video games to pretend that my parents weren't born.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
Oh, and one person in the chat wants me to talk about my little arcade machines. I have I think over 30 different little arcade machines of different sizes that are in my office at Samantha Bee, which I haven't seen for 2 months.
Wow. What I love about what you've done, Mike, is you've combined, like, you love comedy, you love video games, and you combine those with a live comedy show called Shit Arcade, which you've taken all over the country. And when you did it here recently in San Francisco in the before four times, when we were still allowed to leave the house, you were kind enough to actually allow me to be a part of that show, and I was a panelist on the show. Yeah. And just explain the concept of Shit Arcade to people who might not be familiar with it.
So Shit Arcade, it's obviously, I know a lot of people have done things like this, but it was a traveling show I did. I did it in New York, LA, and then I would go to festivals with it, where I would choose the worst games of all time and just make people play through them. And it was a mixture of comedians, game people, media people, and I think, were you the time you played Bill Laimbeer's Combat Basketball? That might have been your episode where it was.
No, I was there when we played Garfield games.
Oh, Garfield games! You played Garfield games.
Boy. But I want to hear more about that game that you just mentioned.
Well, it's called I Didn't Know Who Bill Laimbeer Was Until Like Last Week on the Michael Jordan documentary. Bill Laimbeer apparently was a real basketball player. I just happened to find a Super Nintendo game called Bill Laimbeer's Combat Basketball, which takes place in a dark future where. There's no rules. That's what it
says. Wait. Is this a real game or it's like a homebrew or something? Oh my God.
It's a cyberpunk basketball game, except it's terrible. Like, do you remember that like brand of video games in sort of the early mid 90s where they were like, all right, nerds, you don't like sports, but what if it's sports in the future?
Right, like Cyberball. Remember that one with the robots playing NFL football?
Yeah. Yeah. Like Mutant League Hockey, which wasn't the future, but it was like another way. It's like, you like
right,
this,
right,
nerds.
Right. Like, yeah, it's like, maybe if we make it nerdy, you'll like it. So, and that's been really, Shit Arcade's been really popular. People like the show that we did, people loved it.
Yeah, it. I actually was surprised. Like, I think the last five or six shows I've done around the country have sold out. There have been like, people who have come back to a lot of them. It actually has turned out much, much, much better than I even thought it would be. And it's a shame that right now I can't really do it.
Right. Yeah. I mean, is there any way you could maybe do it? Like, is there a Zoom version of Shit Arcade you could do?
I've thought of doing a Zoom version. I want to figure it out so everyone can play it. I've struggled a little bit with everyone being able to play at once. And that's the thing I'm trying to figure out. But look, you made a good show. So if you can teach me how to do that, I will do that. And you will be my first guest.
I would love that. I'm there. What's interesting about Shit, I mean, I think Shit Arcade is brilliant, but there's a whole slew of content out there, people on YouTube and Twitch, you know, playing bad games, almost like kind of masochistically. What's the appeal of bad video games? Why do we like bad games so much?
I like bad games because there's a certain kind, because you can see that they were still made and someone made them, someone put effort into them, and we're both making fun of them, but at the same time, these are games that have been forgotten, they're not played anymore, and it's interesting to take them out and be like, this existed, this was real. Someone's job was to make this, and I just want to give it one more chance. And sometimes there have been times where like we played Mick Kids and half the audience was like, no, Mick Kids is a good game. So we've actually had disagreements. Like, we played Where's Waldo on the NES at one game, and people started to get so excited by it. Like, the audience was shouting at the stage where to find it. And that's the other thing, like, you were in the Garfield episode. When people were playing Garfield and someone figured out how to beat a level, the crowd explodes in cheers.
Right. Oh yeah, they love it when you do well at bad games.
Right. Yeah. So it's almost like a fun way to like, it's not necessarily like we're just Mystery Science 3000 Theater 3000 ing a game. It's also right. like we're kind of finding a way to actually enjoy a bad game.
Oh, yeah. I actually got into one of those Garfield games. I got stuck in a maze and I was like, no one's taking this controller from me until I get out of this goddamn maze. And people, when I got out of the maze, people cheered. It was like the greatest I've ever felt in my life.
Yeah, no, they get so excited. And the audience is legit cheering. They're not like ironically cheering. They're like, yes, you solved it.
Now, Mike, it wouldn't be a talk show and you wouldn't be a guest on a talk show if you hadn't come here to plug a book. And I know that Adam right now is currently queuing up the link that he's going to drop into the chat. So you have a Kickstarter coming out. There's a great range of books called Bitmap Books, and they're kind of these really cool deep dives into, just weird and wonderful video games. And I know you're working on one. Can you tell us a bit about it?
Yeah, so it's Boss Fight Books, but...
But I'm sorry, I did a book with Bitmap Books. You have Boss Fight Books.
I'm sorry, I was talking about my thing. It was better. Boss Fight Books. Boss Fight Books is a series of books. A lot of you have probably heard of them. And I'm in the fifth season, and I'm writing a book on one of my favorite games of all time, Silent Hill 2. So it's actually my first book I've ever written, and it comes out in December, hopefully, if I can finish the sixth or seventh draft of it in time. And I'm really excited. It's going to be a great season of books. There's Majora's Mask is one of the books. Red Dead Redemption's one of them. There's like a ton of good books in this season. So I'm super excited to be a part of it.
Did they come to you and say, what would you like to write about? Or did they say, hey, would you like to write a book about Silent Hill 2? And was it your idea to write about Silent Hill 2?
They asked me what I wanted to write about. And I was like, what do I want to write about? And at first I was like, what if I wrote about Parappa the Rapper?
That's one of my favorites.
It's one of my favorites too. And they were like, well, do you have like a thorough understanding of music history? And I was like, no, I really don't. And so they were like, maybe that's not the book for you if it's an entire music game and you don't know anything about music. And I was like, you know what? That's true. So then I thought about my favorite games, and I was like, you know what? I love Silent Hill 2. I always come back to it. I think about it all the time. I play it at least once a year. So I pitched Silent Hill 2 and they said yes. And I was like, oh my God, I got Silent Hill 2.
I think when Mary Kish comes on in a moment, you two are going to have a lot to talk about, because Silent Hill is like one of the games she most loves to stream. I think you might be Silent Hill buddies.
I hope so. That'd be great. That'd be great. And I will greatly disappoint her when I miss something in the book that she likes.
We got another clip coming up in a moment of some of your stand-up. But before we get to that, we're in the Animal Crossing world. You're here because you play Animal Crossing. You have an Animal Crossing character. I always like to talk to my guests about Animal Crossing a little bit. Is New Horizons your first experience with Animal Crossing, or do you go back to like the GameCube? Like, what's your Animal Crossing history?
I have been playing it since the GameCube. It came out on GameCube my freshman year of college, and I had five roommates. We had like one of those suites where it's like three bedrooms and a kitchen. And so the four of us, in that time you could have four people making a town, four of us made a town. And it was the best possible time for it to come out. Like, it made us friends. It was that and Smash Brothers Melee. That right. was the best possible freshman year of college you could have.
I love it. I love it. And in New Horizons, what's your approach to playing Animal Crossing? One of the beautiful things about the game is you can play it. You can kind of play the game and create any kind of world that you choose. I kind of feel like you've created some kind of dystopia over there. But I mean, I don't know. Am I reading too much into that? I don't know. What's your Animal Crossing Island like?
Well, I have to say I'm like a little bit behind everyone else because I spent a week basically playing Final Fantasy VII Remake.
I still got to get to that.
When I came back to my Animal Crossing town, people were kind of like, hey, where were you? Like, and I was only gone like 3 days, but they were acting like I had left for good. Like they thought I had ghosted them. So my town is behind everyone else. Really, I want to build a theme park. My goal is to, I really, really, really think a theme park would be super fun. So I'm trying to build a theme park that's going very slowly. But I don't know, I'm kind of just a trash raccoon right now. Like, I'm gathering stuff, I throw stuff away, I sell stuff, then I buy new stuff. I'm like a hoarder.
Yeah, I think many of us are. I'm gonna show a clip. I asked you if you would want to come on and do some stand-up. The problem with this format is that as a stand-up, what do I know? You tell me. But my presumption is that without a live audience to feed off, it's kind of hard to do stand-up on a virtual set, right? Like, that would be difficult to do.
Yeah, like, you sort of imagine without an audience, you don't know a lot of the rhythms of it, so it sounds like you're just doing jokes to silence, which is the problem with a lot of these Zoom shows that you have now. So I thought, you know, it would be honestly much better if I just gave you a clip that I knew already.
Let's do that. Let's see Mike Drucker in his native environment. This is from Kinda Funny Live 2 back in 2016 when Mike brought the house down with an incredible set. We're just going to show like a minute of it. I'm going to issue a trigger warning for this clip, though. You are going to see many people in close proximity in a building together. Like that already seems so weird to me to see that. It's like, what are you all doing? Are you people crazy?
That's so weird.
But we're gonna run the clip real quick. Let me just let's get this clip. Sorry, I'm running the board. I'm doing it all myself. Bear with me. We're kind of building the plane as it's in the air. Let's run a little bit of Mike stand up right here.
When I was 7 years old, I had a writing assignment in my class. If you could be any animal, what would you be and why? My friend Josh wrote, I would be an eagle because eagles can fly. And this girl in my class wrote, I would be a horse because horses are pretty. And I wrote, I would be a jellyfish because when you don't have a nervous system, you can't be sad. So, too real! I was also a very, I know I'm fat now, but I was a super fat kid. Like, very fat kid, and I was really into video games because the two are not mutually exclusive. So one Halloween, because I was so into video games, I decided to dress up as Ryu from Street Fighter 2. No, because every house on my block assumed I was Chris Farley from Beverly Hills Ninja. And I had to go with it because I like candy. Another Halloween, I usually explain this, I don't need to explain it for this crowd, I dressed up as Simon Belmont from Castlevania. Except he's dressed in all leather and has a whip. So I was a 7-year-old obese child going door to door being like, where is your vampire, Kia? And all of the neighbors gave me this weird look that I now know as them thinking, I think Dennis Drucker's fucking his son. Too real.
That is some dark, like that's some dark comedy. I love it, but it's some dark comedy.
Yeah, I guess it's a little dark, but it sort of makes me feel better. It like when I come up with those jokes, it's almost like a nice catharsis to get that out, to be able to express it. I'm sure it's the same when you write a script. You're like, this subject that I really wanted to do, I've got it out there now, and I feel bad about it a little less.
Mike, you've been a great guest. I hope you'll stick around for the rest of the show because we've got some great stuff coming up.
I definitely will.
It is time now. And I know she's in the Discord and she's listening, so she will be at the top of the stairs right now preparing for her grand entrance. And Mike is already very, very professionally and nicely sitting on the correct part of the couch. And it's not difficult to sit on the right part of an Animal Crossing couch because the game's controls are very strange. 7,000 viewers, Adam. We're through the roof. I don't even know what to say. It's time to introduce my next guest. She's a good friend of mine. She used to work for GameSpot. She now works at Twitch. We've got, again, not just comedy royalty on the show today, but Twitch royalty. Like a real live person who actually works at Twitch, the company that makes all this magic possible. Let's actually go to our live airport cam and and check out Mary's grand arrival. We do hear Animal talking. We do have, and this all gives us a glimpse into Mary's personality. She's the very first relocator flying in from the island of homies. Mary, where did that come from? Very first relocator.
I don't know that I added that.
Well, it's what you're known as. It's what you're stuck with. So here we go live to the airport cam. Here comes Mary from homies. Please welcome my good friend, Mary Kish.
There's that.
She's doing the butterfly again. Mary, thanks for joining us.
Oh, thanks for having me. This is really lovely. I can't believe this is my first time on your set.
Well, you know, this is obviously a long-running show. We've been running for a very long time. And I can't believe it's taken this long to get you on the show.
It's just incredible. It's otherworldly to be here. Just something else. I never would have thought it could be possible.
Mary, what exactly do you do at Twitch?
I am head of community marketing. I've been working at Twitch for about 3 years now. I came from GameSpot, and I help make stuff that we think that other people would like and make sure it gets on Twitch for everybody to enjoy and show off all of the cool people that we have making live streams on here, like you.
So do you work directly with streamers?
Yeah, I do. I help make sure that streamers who deserve to be highlighted get those highlights, and categories that need to get some extra love, like food and drink or music, get more attention. So, yeah.
Because Twitch, I mean, Twitch traditionally and still to this day is still predominantly games. But I love the fact, I mean, like my favorite channel on Twitch, and it's where I was streaming for the longest time, was Just Chatting. I just love the crazy stuff that happens on Just Chatting.
Yeah, Just Chatting is right up there, right after games. So people really enjoy watching people hang out. And I think it kind of helps explain that not only do people want to watch people do things, but they want to interact with them. And Just Chatting is probably our number one place for you to go and interact with someone and talk right. to them and actually be a part of the experience as opposed to just watching it.
Right. I had a few people complaining about your audio levels being low, so I just cranked you up in Discord. Mary, give us a few bars so that people can test.
One, two, three. Mary, Mary, Mary. That's me.
I just cranked her to the max in Discord. Okay, there we go.
I can also.
All right, I fixed it. Fixing it live. I'm the host. I'm running the VT. I'm audio engineer. I do it all.
Conan never had to do all this.
I know. Conan just says, I'll be right back after this. He never had to run the ads and worry about audio levels. Yeah, my goodness.
He just had to be funny. Just had to do the jokes.
Exactly. I mean, that's the part that's the part I can't do. I'll do all the other things. I can't be funny. I can just press a button that makes your audio go louder.
Master okay. of trades. Yeah.
So you work directly with streamers. And in fact, you were the person who helped us get on the front page tonight. So I just want to say thank you. Thank you, Mary, so much for getting us this position by letting the powers that be Twitch know that this is the kind of content that is going to be the future of Twitch. Thank you.
Well,
thank you so much.
Well, you guys got all that press, and I think, you know, and you get a bunch
Blowing
of
up.
Press and you have a bunch of people talking about you. So we should be paying attention to stuff like that. So you did it, Gary. Don't clap for me. I literally did nothing.
Mary, what's it like working at Twitch?
It's really exciting, actually. There's always something going on, and it's kind of like working at a wild and crazy, wacky news station that maybe might be like run by children and gerbils. There's always news. There's always stuff going on, but it always kind of feels like madness, and it's organized chaos that we like to observe and report, and it's really fun to be a part of. Every day is different, and it's always exciting. It's truly never boring there, which is the only thing I really wanted from a job, was to not be bored all the time. So it's a cool place, and I really do like what I do. I actually enjoy watching streamers, and now I can actually kind of get away with doing it a lot during my day, so I get to
watch. Yeah, I
want to
talk to you about that.
Yeah.
Now, you used to work at GameSpot before you went to Twitch. What first got you? Were you a gamer as a kid? Are you a lifelong gamer, or did you discover the joys of video gaming later in life?
I was definitely getting into it as a child. My father got a PC for me when I was young. My first console, though, was a Sega Genesis, and so I grew up playing kind of like traditional Sega games. Sonic, we played Jurassic Park, and I had an older sister. So when I say we played, I mean she played, and I watched her a lot. And sometimes I got to play Tails, which is a passive character that doesn't actually get to play in the game. But I fell in love with a lot of games. Lion King and Aladdin were really good games when I was growing up. And so I played those, and that kind of kept propelling me. But I didn't really start feeling it until I got an Xbox 360. And I tried a game that I thought was way out of my wheelhouse called Gears of War. And I didn't think that it would be for me because it was so scary. It looked like really intimidating, but it turns out that it was really appealing. The story was amazing. I fell in love with the characters and Dom, and I got a really good feel for the cover-based shooter mechanics. And so I fell in love with it, and I realized that was actually something I wanted to spend a lot more of my time doing. So I did. I started continuing to play those games and getting the consoles, and I ended up getting a job at a Wii publisher, and that was my first job in the games industry.
As in the Nintendo publisher, not like a
that's
cute,
correct,
not like,
Gary. Not, the Wii.
No, I didn't know if you meant like a cute little publisher.
No, it was it wasn't. Nintendo itself, it was like a side publisher called Zoo Games, and we made like tiny little games for the Wii that most people probably wouldn't recognize, and it kind of got me my start in the industry. That was kind of just my start. But as I was marketing those games, I went to GameSpot to market those games, and I met some really nice people, and I played Gears of War on a live stream ages ago on a live show called On the Spot that used to be on GameSpot like 10 years ago.
Right.
And we had a lot of fun, and I killed some people in Gears of War, and they said, hey, you should work for us one day, and 5 years later I got the job.
You know, I say just
5 years later.
Yeah, as they say in the industry.
Just to go back to something you touched on earlier, I know so it kind of passed me by, but I'm fascinated by it. So many people I know grew up on that Sega Genesis. I was always more of a Super Nintendo guy. It was kind of like one or the other. Mike, were you a Super Nintendo guy or a Sega Genesis guy?
I was a Super Nintendo guy until I had a birthday when I was about, I forget what age, but it was a pretty young birthday. My parents were like, we can either throw you a birthday party or get you a Genesis. And I never had a birthday party again.
I think you made the right call. Mary touched on such of the classics, Aladdin, The Lion King. Obviously, those just got remastered recently. It was great to see those games back. What are your fondest Sega Genesis memories?
Yeah, I actually still go back and play Aladdin and all of the originals, actually. I really do enjoy Lion King still. And I try to play them maybe on streams where I'm raising money for charity because they're really infuriating. And if you guys do remember them, everybody has a lot of good memories of them, but they're really hard. And The Lion King is not an easy game. It's a mean game. And by mean developers. And when we were kids, like, you just dealt with it. So, you know, you had to kind of get in the mindset to play it again, but I'll still play them.
I love it. I love it. And now, and also what I like about you, Mary, not only do you work at Twitch, but you are a very active Twitch streamer. You stream all the time, right?
Yeah, I actually do enjoy streaming on Twitch. I like streaming a lot of scary games, actually. I play Resident Evil right now. And I play Silent Hill. So I've started the Silent Hill series with my friend, Hentai PhD. That's Hentai PhD. She streams on Twitch too. And she and I.
Does she actually have does she actually have a PhD in hentai?
So technically, no, but I would say that the knowledge that she contains is that of a doctorate.
It's
so
like,
I
it's
would
PhD,
say an
PhD equivalent.
Doctorate.
PhD yeah. equivalent. And there's Hentai PhD's Twitch also dropped in the chat there. What is it about horror games that you like? Me? Do you like being scared? Because I don't. I can't play. After Fatal Frame 2, I was like, fuck this. I never played another horror game again.
It makes me feel alive, Gary. It's one of those weird things where kind of like how people get really into horror movies or scary movies and they like to feel that rush. I like to play scary games because it makes me feel no other emotion that I could ever feel IRL. I never feel that scared. When I played PT for the first time, I got more scared than I think I've ever been in my entire life. And although maybe that feeling isn't necessarily a good feeling, it is so unique and so interesting, and I can only experience that when I play these games. So it is fun, and I also do think it's actually funny when you play a scary game with chat as opposed to playing it alone. Like, if you were going to play a scary game, I do encourage you to play it on a stream with other people who get to laugh and enjoy your fear, and that's like a fun experience for everyone.
Do you find that playing the game with the chat takes the edge off the scariness because you're not playing it alone?
Yeah, they get to enjoy it. They like to laugh and get involved just like the rest of us. And sometimes they can anticipate scary things that happen, and I can tell in chat, and it makes me laugh because they know that I'm about to experience something really stressful. So they do take the edge off, and I think it's just a fun experience for everyone to enjoy the tension before. You know, it's just like, it's not actually dying. It's the anticipation of something that's freaky that's about to happen that makes it so exciting. So that's an enjoyable experience.
Is it that you're an adrenaline junkie, or is it like you're like Mike? is it that you're more like Mike, like an emotional husk who just wants to feel something, anything?
Maybe it's like a little bit of A, a little bit of B. I think that I love the rush. And I also, like I said, I think that there are feelings that I only feel when I play scary games that I just don't feel like I'm able to experience when I'm not. So it's a really cool thing to happen. And I feel really strongly about it. I think it's a great experience. I think everyone should enjoy it. So I play Silent Hill on Thursday, and then I play Resident Evil sometimes Tuesday and Wednesday. And then on Mondays, I basically just play indie games, like whatever I feel like. Mondays
are my
day. Yeah,
you're a variety streamer. You play all kinds of stuff.
Yeah, I play whatever I feel like. I feel it's very important to do what you want, because if you're not having a good time, then you're not succeeding. Even if your channel is successful, you need to be happy when you stream. So it's important to me to stream what I want. So Mondays are my day. I just play whatever I feel like. And that could be anything from, like, Shovel Knight to... I was playing Half-Life Alyx in VR recently, and that was really cool.
I gotta get to that.
You should get to that.
Now, you brought a couple of clips. I'm gonna get to the first one. First of all, I just want to tell you my personal horror game story. It's very short, but this was the beginning and the end of my horror game experience. PlayStation 2 era, Fatal Frame 2. Everyone's talking about it. I got the game. It's super scary, and I thought, okay, this is pretty scary. I can handle it, though. I put the game on pause. I don't know if you remember this, but I put the game on pause. The game even fucks with you in the pause mode. Like, even in pause mode, there's, like, a scary, like, one of those kind of Ringu, like, girl faces that kind of slowly, slowly fades into the screen. And it happens so slowly, you don't even notice it until it's, like, right on top of you. And I was like, I'm out. I'm done. And I walked away, and I never played another horror game again. And the next time there was an experience like that, I was at San Diego Comic-Con. And it was the first time trying PlayStation VR. I remember it was me and Major Nelson and Megan Scavio from the Academy of Interactive Arts and Sciences all kind of got snuck in for a secret demo, and we did like the getaway and these cool shooting games, and they said, now we're going to show you this thing called The Kitchen, or it was just called Kitchen. And I said, what is it? And they said, just try it. Just put, you know, it's better if you go in, you know, kind of blind. I said, no, I kind of want to know what it is. And they said, well, are you familiar with Japanese horror? And I just walked out. No, that's not happening. It's just not going to happen. But you did bring a couple of clips from Twitch. This first one, I believe, is you playing The Outer Wilds.
Yeah, if you got them, I don't know which order you have them in, but if
I've got The Outer Wilds queued up right now. So do you want to tee this queue up for this for us?
If you guys have played The Outer Wilds or know anything about it, there's a very particular planet that if you go towards the light, something really crazy happens. And I had never played this game, and I had no spoilers. So this is my organic reaction to finding out what happens when you follow the light.
Let's watch the clip.
I feel like this is what you see before you die. Oh my God.
Some say I'm still recovering from that incident.
You weren't acting, right? That genuinely freaked you out.
I mean, I've never experienced something where I thought maybe I was going to go to another dimension. I thought good things might happen. I was not planning on a fish. So that kind of just the shock got me in that one.
And you're right. I think the reason why horror games are so popular on Twitch is people love to watch those reactions. Some of the most viral streamer clips that I've ever seen are people just freaking out at jump scares in games.
Yeah, I think that's true. I mean, I do every year at TwitchCon, I typically do a top clips of the year, and so many of them are just organic reactions. They're people doing something, and something unexpected happens, and it's how they deal with it. That's kind of why I say, like, with this show, right? Like, some of the best moments might happen not written down on a sheet, not planned. It's just stuff that happens when you're live, and that's what makes these shows so wild. It's like you can't predict everything that's going to happen today.
I hear you. Now, you've brought another clip, and this is you and Hentai PhD playing it, because you guys play games together on stream, right?
That's right. So this is me and Hentai PhD playing Silent Hill 3. So I was saying we play through all the Silent Hills. I've never played a Silent Hill. And Nina's favorite game is Silent Hill 2. So Mike, you and Nina would get along really well. And she was kind of coaching me through the series and explaining all the nuance and all the weird stuff about holes. And there's just like a lot of weird references and strange stuff in that game. The whole game is really weird. That's right, holes. And yeah, it's very hole-based. Anyway.
We've moved on from loads, Adam. Remember when loads was the comedy word of the last show? Now it's holes.
It's going to definitely be holes. In Silent Hill 3, this is kind of like a scary section. I don't think we're talking about anything in particular. We're just kind of reacting about the characters. But we're in a very scary hallway.
But the point of this clip, and I'm not going to spoil it. We're just going to run it. The point of this clip is not the scariness. I'll just say this. If you appeal, and Mike, you'll like this. If the lowest levels of base humor appeal to you, you're going to love this clip. Let's run it.
Well, I wouldn't walk into a fucking swarm of moths personally, but I can't speak for this woman.
Her personal experiences are different than yours.
Chad, did you hear that? Oh, they heard it.
I'm so glad you brought that clip, Mary.
You
took the pulse. You took the pulse of this show, the comedy tone of this show. You nailed it perfectly.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Mike Drucker's comedy is like at least like an 8 or 9 level. So I thought I'd bring us back down to like a 3 or a 4.
That was amazing.
I don't deserve that, but I appreciate it. Thank
you. Now another popular kind of streamer, and this is another very popular category, and you really enjoy doing it, is you like to play Just Dance, right? You like to dance on stream.
Yeah, I like to play Just Dance, especially for charity streams. So we do a lot with charity on Twitch generally. You'll see so many charities going on all the time. And every year I do a charity for the kids, and I typically do Just Dance. And I even did Just Dance with some of my friends, and we all dance together. And we have a really good time doing it. It's really fun. The audience gets to get involved, and we'll do like costumes and stuff like that for donations for the kids. So it's a really sweet thing to do. And it's also good exercise. Yeah, especially right now.
Now, you didn't bring a clip, but I wanted to make sure that we checked that box. So I actually brought a clip of my own.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. So, you know, the lockdown, we're all at home. We've got a second grader, our 7-year-old daughter here at home. And we hit upon this idea of getting her moving, trying to get her some activity at home. She's loving Ring Fit Adventure, and she loves Just Dance. So we figured in the morning, let's get her dancing. But she often insists on dancing with me. She wants me to dance too. And, you know, unbeknownst to me, the game randomly captures you with the PlayStation camera. And so this is actually a clip that I uploaded to YouTube, but I had it unlisted private so no one could see it. But I'm gonna share it with you tonight. Against my better judgment, I'm gonna share this clip with you tonight. So it's real short. It's only about 30 seconds. While Raquel gets into position and warms up, we're gonna play this clip right now. And God help me, I hope you enjoy it.
This is amazing, Gary.
That's it. That's all I wanted to share with you. That's all I wanted to share with you.
Why does it capture that while you're doing it?
It captures a random part. It tells you when it's doing it, but it just randomly turns the camera on, and then at the end it plays back that little clip.
You know, Gary,
Yeah.
I have to say, you and I have been very liberal with our use of hair on our characters.
Well, you know, somebody, I was on Kind of Funny Games Daily earlier today. And yeah. And someone asked me, because I did my Games Daily performance as my talk show character from behind the desk here. Because, you know, I'm shameless and I'll take any opportunity to promote this show.
No, of course. No, I'm the same way.
And someone asked me, wait, why does Gary's character have hair? And it's kind of like saying, well, why does your barbarian in Warcraft have muscles and you don't? It's like, you know, it's you don't. I'm not playing myself in the game. I'm playing the character I want to be. I want to be a glamorous talk show host in a wonderful tailored suit and beautiful coiffured hair instead of the balding, overweight, works in his pajamas that he hasn't changed in 3 days guy that I actually am. That's who I want to be. That's the aspirational part of this.
You can change the pajamas, though.
I can, Adam, but I choose not to. I'm a grown-up. I pay my taxes. I can do what I want.
I wasn't taking you down that far.
We are about. I just went over. I just saw that Raquel is ready. And so we're about to enter the real serious high wire part of this show. And I really hope this works, because if it works, it's going to be my favorite part of the show. We really want to take this to the next level. We are very fortunate to have with us tonight. I imagine she's probably unmuting her mic as we speak, getting ready to go. I'm going to do a little bit of magic here. I really, really hope this works, because I don't know if anyone's ever tried anything like this. We're going to try. A little while ago, while I was wandering around on Twitch, I completely by accident discovered a young singer-songwriter by the name of Raquel Lily, and she had such an amazing voice, and she was so talented. I like signed up to her channel right away, and I just like I gotta have more of this, and I've been a fan of her channel ever since. And we're so fortunate to have her with us here tonight, ladies and gentlemen, Raquel Lily.
Sunny skies I saw when she is by my side. Caress her lips with my fingertips. Smile glowing so bright in the pale moonlight. An evergreen, such a timeless queen. Cherry light, she makes me feel all right. Stay with me all night. I ain't got no shame, ain't no other day. She's the one. She's got the stuff. She's loud and a bit obscene, if you know what I mean. Boys lining up, but she'll call your bluff. Ain't no one in town can touch that crown. Her majesty makes me weak in the knees. Cherry light, she makes me feel all right. Stay with me all night. I ain't got no shame. Coffin, you can't clear her by yourself.
Amazing.
That was amazing.
I am absolutely blown away. Not only did that work on the technical level that I hoped it would work at, and we had to figure out a lot of bits of magic there to make that work the way that we wanted it to, but Raquel is just so incredibly talented. Come over here and join us on the couch. We're gonna make room for you. Mike, you're a stand-up. Stand up.
Is that the bit you told us about?
Remember,
beforehand?
I said I had a bad joke. That was the bad joke. I'm sorry we don't have a seat for you, but the way in which Animal Crossing works in this little room, I can't actually get three seats lined up in a way that everyone can move around. So I apologize for that. Raquel, thank you so much for that beautiful performance.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
It's wonderful, wonderful. I'm so, you know, one of the things that I wanted to try to do on the show. Early on was get a musical guest just to kind of like make it feel like a real talk show, and that it's something that we could really pull off. And you helped us do it in a way that completely surpassed my expectations. Just wonderful. Thank you so much. So you are obviously a musician, a singer-songwriter, and you have a Twitch channel, but you also, you know, release music on Spotify, and you know you're out there. You know, kind of in the internet age of music. How did you first get it? Did you get into music in a young age? It's obviously your passion. Like where did it all start? What were your early musical influences?
Yeah, so I grew up pretty much singing since I could remember, and really just started singing at an early age. I grew up in a musical family. My brother sings, my mom and dad sang, and very fortunate to be kind of surrounded by a lot of that art. And you know, growing up in the Philippines, if you can either sing or dance or do both,
right?
So it definitely was ingrained in me at a young age, and I just continued to kind of pursue it on the side. I actually have a degree in neurobiology, so it's not what I intended to do professionally, and I went through the ropes of going to college and getting a degree, and then when I graduated, I started working in the medical field, and I realized that that's, you know, I've always kind of known it, but that's not where I belonged. I always wanted to be a creative and kind of flourish in that field and flex those muscles that I've always had. So as far as, I guess, influences, I grew up listening to a lot of songwriters that I look up to. So like the Beatles and Amy Winehouse, Marvin Gaye, Stevie Wonder, just a lot of the really amazing classics, and I just kind of aspire to this day to be just like them. And I got into music production, and then I started kind of releasing my own stuff on my own terms. And then I got into Twitch, and kind of the rest is history.
So I mean, I like to sing. I like to sing in the shower. I sing sometimes in the kitchen, and my daughter physically attacks me when I sing. It's like she hates it so much, and it's very discouraging. I clearly don't have a career as a singer in my future, or what's left of it. But like, we all like to sing, but like, when did you first realize that like you were good at it? Did somebody need to tell you, or did you already kind of know that you had a great voice?
Man, I still don't think I'm good at it. You know, there's always like a, pursuit.
I'm here to tell you. And there's 11,000 people in the chat right now who are here to tell you that you have an amazing voice and you're an incredible talent.
I appreciate that. I think it's really important to stay humble in this field, especially because that's how you get better. And I don't know when I'm ever going to get to a point where I'm like, oh man, I've made it. I'm great. But hopefully I never get there.
You know what? I'm obviously in a different creative field, but I can tell you it's the same across all creative fields. As soon as you get to that point, it's too late. You've lost the plot. As soon as you start telling yourself that you're the best, something has gone horribly awry. Now, it's fascinating to talk to you just as someone who is a great musical talent, but it's also really into you. You know, we're on Twitch. I found you on Twitch. What's it like? There's obviously a very vibrant music scene on Twitch. What's it like being a musician on Twitch?
So I've been on Twitch for about 3+ years, and when I first got on it, it was a struggle. It still, in some aspects, is, but I don't know if you guys know, but there's like a music tab now on the main page of Twitch, so it's a lot easier to access. I'd say 3 years ago, and in the past 3 years, it's definitely been a commonplace for people to be like, I don't know there was music on Twitch, but now there's literally no excuse. Like, there's a tab. I love it. But yeah, being a musician on Twitch wasn't always what I did. I actually started off as a gamer. I grew up playing a bunch of games, and I think got to a point in my life where I just felt really guilty over the amount of time I spent gaming. So I'm like, let me try and be constructive and maybe like sing karaoke songs while I shoot other players in the face. It'll be fun. So I actually started off playing Overwatch and other FPS games, and I would karaoke songs while I played. And then I just kind of picked up my guitar one day and started playing music like on Just Chatting or I think it was Creative at the time. And that took off faster than my gaming thing, which I spent a few months on trying to kind of build. I realized that the audience that I was building doing music was much more, I don't know, faithful, really. Everybody was like super into what I was doing, and I felt much more unique in the space that was Twitch. And right. It's definitely grown since then, and I think it's still growing, but it's come a long way from where it was.
Mary, so you obviously, again, you work at Twitch. Is music, do you see, do the people that work at Twitch see music as a big part of Twitch these days?
Yeah, now more than ever, actually. What we're seeing is the biggest influx of music streamers and people who are coming to the site to listen to music more than ever before. So it's good for everyone all around. It's been a huge surge, and I think a lot of that is, some of it is the world that we live in, right? We can't go to concerts, so people are enjoying their concerts in the safety of their home. And I think another part of it is that Twitch and the world is ready for live interactive musical experiences. You know, when you think about going to a concert, it's not passive. You're hanging out with your friends, you're talking and having a good time. And ideally, like, Twitch is that kind of thing too, where you get to actually ask Raquel Lily for a song, right? Or you get to have her read your name. That's pretty cool. And so that's kind of growing on the site, and we're really excited about it.
It's amazing. It's amazing. Now, I got more to talk to Raquel about, and she's actually going to do another song for us before we're done tonight. But I want to let you in on a little bit of magic here. So, if you're over on Twitch, if you're over on Raquel's channel, she's streaming right now on her own channel, and you can actually see the real Raquel, not the avatar version that we have here. And if you go over there, what you'll see is that she's not actually playing Animal. Unlike the rest of us, she's the only one in the room right now. And in fact, the first guest that we've had who isn't actually playing Animal Crossing. She doesn't have Animal Crossing because who can get a Switch these days? I mean, you can't get them. It's absolutely impossible to get them. So what we came up with was this kind of idea where if there's someone that we think is fascinating, we really want to have on the show, but for whatever reason they don't have Animal Crossing, or it's too difficult for them to bring their character to the island, what we do is, and what we did for Raquel is, Leah, my wife and executive producer, actually gave her own avatar. That's actually Leah on the couch right now. That's Leah's character, and we completely modified her to look like Raquel. And Raquel approved the look, and she picked out her shoes and her dress and her hair and the whole thing. And while Raquel is performing live and in the Discord, Leah is actually puppeteering her avatar. So it's like some Henson Company magic that's happening right now. Like, Leah's doing all those emotes I'm sure Raquel is getting a kick out of this right now. But she's, it might have been a little bit too much to ask Raquel to kind of hold a guitar and sing and play, and at the same time actually play Animal Crossing. So, you know, while we always, you know, this was originally a way for us to get people who play Animal Crossing on the show, but we do now have the technology to bring people onto the show, even if they don't have Animal Crossing. We'll create a custom avatar for you. We'll control it from our end. And all you need to do is call into the Discord and provide the actual cool stuff, which is talking in chat. Raquel, I don't know if you're aware, but you are part of like a very wacky experiment right now.
Yeah, I enjoy being a guinea pig, so let's go.
So you've been, you said you've been on Twitch for like three and a half years now?
Yeah, almost four, coming up on four.
And you're obviously, and you're out there doing all kinds of other things as well. You're making music videos, you know, you're on Spotify. How important is Twitch as part of like your entire platform as an artist? And if there's someone else out there who wants to sing and write songs and get noticed, would you recommend a Twitch channel as a way to kind of build a career in music?
For sure. I think it's two parts. For me personally, you know, I grew up with a very similar community. Like I played World of Warcraft obsessively growing up. So I always kind of had like internet friends, and that whole community was never foreign to me. So I think Twitch for me socially was like a natural, like, oh yeah, I get this community. I get this culture. There's definitely a cultural thing that you have to embrace as a musician. Right. That I feel like just your normal musician who's coming off, you know, a tour or a bar, who's never gamed or done any of this internet stuff, it's gonna be totally weird and foreign. But yeah, as far as my, like how my career went, I kind of plateaued. Like I'd say I got like really locally famous and you know, my name kind of in the Southeast. I live in Atlanta now, but I gained a lot of notoriety locally for what I was doing. But I felt like after a certain point, you know, it was hard to grow, and it's hard to connect to other people otherwise. So I think putting my music out on the internet and being able to like play live and show people that I could do what I could do and produce my own music and put it out there, and then have a platform like Twitch to promote, let's say, my Spotify or whatever single I'm releasing, or any music videos like on different platforms like YouTube. It's synergistic, I'd say. And I definitely recommend it to people who want to build a community outside of just like your normal going on tour and gathering fans that way. And another thing about Twitch is like, I don't know any other platform where you could have such a personal experience with your viewers and your fans and have everyday conversations and influence people in their everyday life. And not only am I playing music, I'm you know, going on tour and showing everybody what I do on stage. I get to show them the backstage stuff. It's like such a plethora of tools you have as a musician, not only to show your music, but just like to share your life.
So, I mean, that's what I was going to ask you about. Like, obviously the key element of Twitch is the interaction. You've got the chat up on the screen. You're interacting with your audience in a way that, like, even at an intimate kind of concert venue, you wouldn't be able to do that, right?
Well, you know, I don't know. I'm kind of one of those people who really likes to ask for forgiveness rather than like, you know, ask permission. So I'm always kind of someone who tries to push the boundaries. Luckily, I haven't been banned yet. But yeah, I don't know. I think it's part of the artistry, is like figuring out how you could be creative in the space that isn't, you know, traditionally catered towards what you're doing, and figuring out how to make it work.
What I like about your channel is you, and we're going to show a clip in a moment, you take requests, right? You'll take requests, and correct me if I'm wrong, I think this is right, you're kind of like a living jukebox, right? People can kind of tip you to get their song to the top of the list and jump the line, is that right?
I'm like a spicy jukebox. Like, I yell and curse at people if I think their song sucks. But yeah, I do have a song list that people can request from, which is, this is what makes my channel unique to the live shows that I play. Because when I play live shows, when I tour, it's all originals. And you guys just heard Mary, which is an original that I perform. But on my Twitch, it's unique because you don't normally watch your, you know, your favorite musician up on stage playing other people's songs unless it's like a special one song moment kind of thing.
Right.
So
right,
on Twitch,
right.
it's like this is my way of like kind of speaking to people on a different level. Like it's not just about me showing off my originals. It's about me singing Wonderwall or Baby Shark or Lord, please don't come into my channel and request those. but yeah, it's like I have a list that people can request from, and I think that's what makes my Twitch channel a unique experience over watching me perform live.
I just changed your Chiron, by the way, to you're now not special guest Raquel Lily, you're now Spicy Jukebox Raquel Lily. I think that name's gonna stick.
Maybe.
Yeah.
I think it's going
to
stick.
Add her Spotify link to there too.
We're going
to.
Oh, yeah,
so,
that'd
and
be great.
I'm way ahead of you, Adam. I've got stuff queued up over here. You don't even know about. You don't know the half of it.
Oh.
You don't know the half of it. I'm going to. So you did bring a clip from your channel. So people who.
I did.
Who see you around. I actually think we got. I mean, I don't know. Do you think we got a pretty good likeness of you in Animal Crossing?
I think so. Dude, I'm actually wearing a very similar dress. So
you
for those of you who are in my channel, I picked this out to match my avatar.
Right. No, it looks, you know, it looks great. I'm actually going to wait. So for anyone who hasn't been to your channel before, I'm going to play a clip right now. And they've already met the Animal Crossing Raquel Lily. We're going to switch over right now. And we're going to play a short clip from your Twitch channel, twitch.tv/Raquel. And we're going to see just a little moment, just a quick 30 seconds of the real Raquel Lily. Amazing. I love it. What a great channel you have over there. It really is one of my favorite Twitch channels. It's always at the top of my favorites list. Raquel, are you going to... We talked about it before the show, so I hope I'm not ambushing you. Would you be good enough to do another song for us?
Hell yeah, let's do it.
All right, let's get over here. I'm going to step over here so I can get the camera set up. Right, Mike, you can go sit down again if you want.
Great.
Let me get set up here. Let me get positioned. I kind of like this angle because, like, I can angle it so you can't see me, but from a certain angle, it also looks like as Raquel's singing, I'm kind of lurking in a very sinister way behind the fern here. Okay, let's see.
The aesthetic.
it's a good aesthetic. Raquel, are you ready?
Yes.
Okay, go for it. Take it away.
Ooh, 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 ooh. Was it you or was it me who put away the memories? Never learned to disagree, save me the heartache. Never threw me a party, didn't see a point in me. Wondering if you'd even see before I leave. Let's not pretend that you or I didn't reach out. So I'll pack my bags and I'll just quietly leave town. And I'm scared to even know if you care to see me go. So I'm leaving without saying goodbye. I'm leaving before you can reply. I'm leaving, and now you wonder why I'm leaving. So you had, I Don't know if I'm just a sap or if you will think back. Feeling stupid as hell for reaching out at times. I know you won't reciprocate, no, you don't have to lie. I'm not one of them, no, I'm not even close. So let's not pretend that you will come to all my shows. And I'm scared to even know if you care to see me go. So I'm leaving without saying goodbye. I'm leaving before you can reply. I'm leaving, and now you wonder why I'm leaving. So you don't have to cry. What can I do? What can I do? What can I do? When all you've done is disrespect me through and through. A pity for years, reaping what I sown. If you've ever felt anything, well, now I'll never know. So I'm leaving without saying goodbye. I'm leaving before you can reply. I'm leaving, and now you wonder why I'm leaving. So you don't have to cry. I'm leaving. Ooh.
Amazing.
Thank you guys so much.
That was I'm at a loss for words on every level. I don't even know where to start with this thing. That was that was amazing. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I'm hoping that we're going to have a lot of great musical guests on the show. There's some other some of my other favorite Twitch streamers, Rick. I don't know if you're familiar with these other channels, but you know, I'm a big fan of the Dapper Rapper. We're hoping to have him on. He's already booked. We're going to have him on next month. The Dapper Rapper will be here in sometime in early May. And then there's another a guy from New Zealand, a multi-talented musician by the name of Very Handsome Billy, who has an incredible
channel. Yeah,
I
know both of them.
And he's going to be on the show. You know what? I haven't even asked him, but I assume we'll get him on the show. He's a good friend of the channel here. He's always happy when I pop into his channel. So I'm hoping that we'll be able to get him on as well, even with the crazy time difference between here and New Zealand. Raquel is exempt from what's about to happen next. She did 2 songs. She has done more than enough. But I did tell Mike and Mary prior to the show that we have a longstanding tradition here on the channel that we ask all of our guests to tell a joke. Just step up to the mic and tell a joke. Now, I hope that Mike and Mary have one prepared, because I did tell them if they don't have one prepared, it's on them. It's on them, not me. So I'll let you guys fight it out. Who wants to go first?
I don't want to follow a professional comedian. Get out of my way, Mike.
It looks like, yeah, you don't want to go on after Mike. It looks
don't
like
worry,
Mike.
I got a horrendous one to follow, a professional comedian.
I'm going to look. Oh, Adam, do you want to do another one? Because all yours so far have been terrible.
You just don't have a good sense of humor.
All right.
And it's not dairy based.
Yeah. What do I know about comedy, Adam? I only created a cartoon talk show in 72 hours. What do I know? Mary, the floor is yours.
All right. How's everybody doing tonight? Good, good.
Man, Wikipedia is really cool right now. Everybody's using it. I love Wikipedia. In fact, last week I got so into Wikipedia, I got worried and thought, what's going to happen if this doesn't exist anymore? So I illegally downloaded all of Wikipedia. And now I know that's against the law and that's not allowed, but I just felt like it was something that needed to be done, and I wanted it, and I wanted all that information. And so last week the cops showed up at my front door and they started to arrest me, and I said, guys, I can explain everything. That's the joke.
I'm gonna give that one to you. I'm gonna give you that one.
When you have to finish it with, that's the joke.
You know what you know what I need to add to this soundboard, Adam, is some crickets. I was fascinated by that joke. I feel like the journey was better than the destination, in the sense that I get like, it was like the whole time I was like, where is this going?
That's life.
Where is this going? Mike Drucker, professional stand-up comedian, a man who does this for a living. Please tell us a joke.
All right. Hey, everybody. How's it going? Hi, Twitch. Good to see you. So I used to, you know, as Gary and I talked about, I used to work on The Tonight Show, which was in Rockefeller Center. Rockefeller Center is a very touristy area, very touristy. And tourists often ask me for help because, not like my avatar, I look non-threatening. So one time this tourist was asking me for help, and English was not his first language, which is fine. I don't mind helping anybody. He was like this tall, giant German dude. You know, like he looked like a Santa Claus that lifts. Like he was like, you know what I mean? Like when you see an old person, you're like, oh, that's what a hot old person looks like. So it's this giant German dude. And what he was trying to ask me was, where's the subway? He just wanted to know where the subway was. But what he ended up asking me was, where's the Underground Railroad? And there was like half a second where he could have shattered my reality if he just grabbed me by the shirt and was like, what year is it? that's my joke, everybody.
You got a genuine LOL out of me, Mike. That's good
thank
enough
you,
for me.
Thank you.
Yeah, Adam, come on. He's, yes. Poor Adam's so desperate to tell a joke. Let's make him happy.
Adam's the goat right now.
Make the boy happy. All right, here we go. Adam Nickerson, everyone.
All right, is this thing on? Okay. Why did the Scarecrow win an award? He was outstanding in his field.
I stepped on that. I'm sorry. I thought you were waiting for the why.
Telling jokes is hard. How do you do it?
I told you it wasn't about
Mike's a very aggressive comedian. Not only does he tell funny jokes, he steps on other comedians' jokes. Like, just to make sure. Just to make sure they're not a threat to him. He snuffs out any threat at the source. I like that. That was good. Well done, Mike. If you'd like to look in your inventories right now, you'll be able to peruse your gifts. Feel free to open up your gifts.
Over in front of the desk there.
Raquel, since you're not really here, we don't have a gift for you. I apologize for that.
Oh, boo.
But Leah is gonna open the gate for you.
Do we open it all at once?
It really is a god awful gift. Yeah, yeah.
Is it though?
I got a gold nugget. That's a great gift. I got gold.
Wait, there's a gold nugget in there?
You guys gave me a gold nugget. I don't
Adam,
know.
Adam, what the hell are you doing? Giving away gold nuggets?
I got a goddamn raccoon.
That's what you're supposed to get. That's what you're supposed to get. So this raccoon over here, which is absolutely the worst object in the entire game. Adam sends these to me every day just to troll me. And so I put one on the set in tribute to that, and we just decided to make that the show gift.
Yeah, but you, for some reason, decided you weren't even going to open the presents I was sending you. You were just going to immediately re-gift them, and that pissed me off. So I wrapped some gold. And I
oh shit!
And I said,
saboteur.
That is some next level stuff.
And you were oh like, "Oh my god, you not even gonna open this?"
Punked me. You punked me.
Now you don't get the gold.
All right, you know what, Adam. I don't know what I've got here. What can I even give you? I'll give you a shot. My hat's off to you, sir. That is some next level shade right there. That's incredible. That's incredible. We have just a couple of last little bits of business to take care of here. Everyone get their party poppers out. Everyone get those party poppers. All right. So now don't pull your poppers yet. I just want to say, first of all, I just want to say thank you, thank you, thank you to everyone who has made this show possible, myself included, Adam, Leah, my wife, and of course our guests here, Mike Drucker, Mary Kish, and Raquel Lily. It's been an amazing show. We have another amazing show on Friday morning at 9 a.m. Writer-director Duncan Jones and actress, writer, polymath Felicia Day will be here at 9 a.m. Friday. And that's going to be another just drop-dead banger of a show. I'm absolutely convinced of that. So stick around. Stick around on Friday for that. Stick around for the raid. The party is just starting. We're going to go over to my friend Snowbike Mike, and we're going to hit him with the mother of all raids. He's playing Call of Duty Warzone right now. He's one of the nicest guys that I know. He and I are going to be co-hosting an Xbox podcast on Kinda Funny coming up soon. I'm very excited to share that with you. From me, from everyone at Animal Talking, thank you so much for a wonderful show. Hopefully the beginning of many more to come. Everyone, on your poppers. 1, 2, 3, go.